Welcome to McMaster University, and a warm welcome to all of you. I think we have a treat in front of us. We're going to be talking about education, but particularly about purpose. A few months ago, I was in Dubai on a terrace having breakfast with our speaker, and he was talking about purpose. But his purpose stemmed from a spiritual activity. And I was talking about purpose, which stemmed from a very secular outlook. And it was amazing that it took us all of 30 seconds to connect and talk about purpose in terms of ethics, morality, in terms of what we want to do for the world. And that, of course, is what attracted me to McMaster University. Soon, our president, Dr. Patrick Dean, will introduce our speaker. But Dr. Dean, of course, exemplifies that through his mission and his statements about moving forward with integrity. At this university, we just don't want to move forward. But when we move forward, we have to consider impact, we have to consider social consciousness, and indeed, we must do so with integrity. Yesterday, we had another speaker, and he was talking about something completely different. He was talking about the confluence of innovation and biomedical engineering. And he was asked a question: what do you think about McMaster? And he said, it's just amazing. Every time I come to McMaster, I get that same sense. This is one of the few universities in the world, in Canada, that concerns itself with social consciousness. So when I think about McMaster University, he said, I think about social consciousness. He was an alumni of this university. Dr. Dean, of course, is the president. And there are several of us in this room who've come here since that alumnus graduated, before Dr. Dean arrived on this campus, and after he did. But I think all of us embrace that concept of impact, of social consciousness. So I'm very thankful that you're here. I think you'll really enjoy this lecture today. It's the 31st Hodgins Lecture. The lecture is named after Dean Hodgins, the first Dean of Engineering. And his vision was to have McMaster Engineering as one of the shining lights in the world. But to shine, we know now, also because of the things he did, the people he hired, that it's not just enough to be discoverers. It's not just enough to have ideas. It only matters when your ideas are embraced and they bring about positive change in the world. I'm also very pleased to welcome the hundreds, and I believe even more than that, virtual visitors to this lecture. We are live streaming this today all over the world through two portals, one at McMaster University and the other at the University of Notre Dame in the United States. So welcome to our virtual visitors as well. Welcome to McMaster University. And it's my great pleasure now to introduce to you our president, Dr. Patrick Dean. Patrick.
Well, many thanks, Ishwar, for that introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here. The Hodgins Lecture is a high point of the year here at McMaster. And always an occasion for stimulating an interesting discussion. And this year's lecture, I think, promises to be very much in that tradition. A modest topic, I might point out, the purpose of higher education. So Peter may not need his full hour. It is obviously an issue that preoccupies us all. As society changes and its demands change, these institutions also do have to change, but they also have to be true to some fundamental principles. which are part of their history and part of their ongoing social and cultural and technological mission. So these are the big questions, and I'm delighted to be here today and to introduce Dr. Kilpatrick to talk. Peter, we're delighted to have you here, to welcome you to our community. As I was just remarking, I had a look at your schedule, and it seems as though we're going to work you very hard, both today and for the rest of the stay. There's something very timely to this lecture. During the month of March, we are thinking of engineering. This is Engineering Month, featuring a showcase and a celebration of engineering excellence in Canada. And this is, I think, a splendid addition to the dynamics of Engineering Week happenings to welcome such an accomplished scholar and teacher to our university. So we certainly look forward to hearing your reflections on the issues that animate higher education from its liberal arts roots, the days of the trivium in late antiquity through to the more specialized degrees of today. As Dean Puri mentioned, we are, as educators, responsible for preparing young minds to become good citizens, not just technologically competent players. And that, of course, leads to the whole question of those so-called soft skills, communication skills, problem-solving skills, leadership, and so on, which, when harnessed with technology, can lead to real social benefit. So I'm pleased to share a few highlights about our speaker. Peter Kilpatrick serves as the McCloskey Dean of Engineering. He is an accomplished teacher and researcher. Having joined the University of Notre Dame in January of 2008, he came there from North Carolina State University, where he had served as chair of the Department of Chemical and Biomolecular Engineering since 1999. He'd been a member of the NCSU faculty for a total of 25 years. Dr. Kilpatrick conducts research in colloidal and interfacial science with an emphasis on the colloidal and molecular properties of crude oil and on biological membranes. His work is leading to oil production and refining that is both more energy efficient and better for the environment. Among his accomplishments, Dr. Kilpatrick served as founding director of NCSU's Biomanufacturing Training and Education Center, an institute dedicated to educating students about pilot-scale protein manufacturing with the aim of providing exceptional training to the next generation of biomanufacturers. Dr. Kilpatrick earned his bachelor's degree in chemistry from Occidental College in Los Angeles and his doctorate in chemical engineering from the University of Minnesota. And lastly, I wish to congratulate Dr. Kilpatrick as the chair-elect for the Global Engineering Deans Council. The council serves as a global network of engineering deans to leverage the collective strengths of the deans for the advancement of engineering education, research, and service to the global community. And I'm very pleased to add, too, that Dr. Puri has recently joined the executive committee of that very esteemed group. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Kilpatrick.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Dean, for that fine introduction. And Ishwar, thank you so much for the invitation to come and share some thoughts and comments about the purpose of higher education, which I'm almost a little embarrassed at the title of my talk because it is a very auspicious and profound title for a lecture, and yet I feel it's so important that we constantly examine and re-examine what we're about as educators at great universities around the world, because the landscape of higher education has really shifted somewhat in the last many years. So if you'll bear with me, first of all, I owe Dr. Dean a real debt of thanks for his byline, Forward with Integrity, because I think this captures very wonderfully you know, just a central element of what I'd like to be about with my comments today. And I looked up the definition of integrity, and I found two. The quality of being honest, having strong moral principles, moral uprightness, and the second, the state of being whole and undivided. And I think both of these are really important and central issues that relate to the purpose of higher education. And I hope by the end of my talk, maybe I've begun to convince you of that. So the outline of the lecture, I'm going to go rather quickly through the challenges facing higher education. Maybe you know of the challenges facing higher education. We deal with them every day in the United States, not so much maybe in Canada. It seems like your government and provincial government really do support higher education at a very high level. I want to talk about the purpose of a university education, and then I want to delve a little bit into the liberal arts, as Patrick indicated, and talk about the ways of knowing, and in particular, the ways of intellection, and how those ways are very important to probe in a university education. And then I want to talk about the whole person and come back to beauty and integrity as tools, really. As you know, now, beauty and integrity should always be ends, but I'm actually going to talk about them as means to an end, and that's the end of an education. And I'll say a few words about engineering education in particular and make some concluding remarks. So perhaps you've heard of some of these books. Excellent Sheep made a big splash last year, if any of you have read that book. Academically Adrift made a comparably big splash a few years ago. There's this book on higher education and the problems that it has. Crisis on Campus is another one. I could go on and list 15 or 20 other books. But people are questioning, at least in the United States, and I would say in the Western world, what is the value proposition of a higher education? Are we getting all the value that we need? What about the cost to the community, to the student, to the government? Are we really reaping the maximum benefit? I think the answer is of course we're reaping the benefit. You know, higher education has been the engine of economic development and the engine of founding the knowledge economy in developed countries and increasingly in developing countries. But sometimes it's good to look at the facts. So here's a simple fact that comes from the Pew Center that shows earnings and unemployment for different education levels varying from doctoral degrees to no high school diploma. And it's pretty obvious from that plot that there's a lot of value in the value proposition. Another way of saying that is here's the average earning potential of a doctoral person versus someone without a high school degree. But you don't want to look just in terms of economic benefit. And as you look at economic benefit, you also want to consider what's the cost. And it is true, if you look at student debt, that there's a growing debt problem in the United States. So despite the fact that the value proposition, at least monetarily, is clear, it's also clear that more and more students are taking on greater and greater debt. And universities like Notre Dame and many of the Ivies and a lot of the top universities in the United States are very concerned about the cost of a higher education. And I know at my school, we're working very hard in the next decade to go to a fully funded university where our students won't pay anything. And that's an interesting proposition. Rice was that way at the very beginning of its founding, but then because everyone else was charging for a higher education and the notion that you get what you pay for, Rice felt compelled to begin to charge for tuition. So what is the purpose of a higher education? First of all, I would argue it's not about knowledge or the content of knowledge. I can deliver content of knowledge to pretty much anyone over the internet. A MOOC can do that. I would maintain that's not higher education. That's content delivery. Is it about developing skills and competencies? Well, Certainly, that's one of the benefits of a higher education. You learn how to manipulate perhaps a 3D printer in engineering. You learn how to maybe go through a design process, so you learn some skills and competencies associated with design. But I would argue that's not the purpose of a higher education. It's not about getting a job. And I worry when the conversation in higher education begins to revolve exclusively, as I just did a few minutes ago, about how much money you can earn, what kind of job can you get, what's the percentage unemployment. If that's the only framework in which we talk about the value of a higher education, I think we're in deep trouble. I think we've kind of lost sight of what the purpose is. So what is the purpose? Is it something greater than these things? Well, I'm going to argue that the purpose of a higher education is to form the human person. Now, that's kind of a bold statement. Aren't human persons like Ryan over here already formed by the time they come to college? And the answer is, well, yes, of course, in part. But you've never acted as an independent agent until you've come to college. You've never been challenged with maybe some higher levels of intellection until you come to a college or a university setting. So there's clearly something that a university does in terms of formation that you haven't experienced before you get to a university. And I would argue that it has something to do with lifelong learning, learning how to teach yourself. I always tell my students, the most important thing I can teach you has nothing to do with content. It has with you learning how to teach yourself. Because anything you learn in engineering may well be obsolete in 10 years. And so it's not about the content that I teach you, and it's not about the skills and the competency that I teach you. It's about your ability to be sufficiently critical and sufficiently well-armed and sufficiently competent that you can teach yourself, that you can be a lifelong learner. But it's more than that. I would argue that the purpose of a higher education is to learn the ways of knowing. So one of the things that's unique about us as human persons is the ways that we know things. You know, there are two things that human persons do, I would argue, that, and I might wax a little spiritually here, that other animals typically do not do, and that's to know and to love. And these are pretty important things to learn how to do well. I think thinking critically is also another important, and what I mean by critically is question the foundations of knowledge. Question what it is that you learn. And one of the most interesting examples that I like to give of questioning is there were two incidences in the history of physics in the 20th century where the total paradigm of physics was destroyed and turned upside down. And one was the demise of Newtonian mechanics as the deterministic method of describing the universe, and the other was the disappearance of the notion that we only had four forces and we're about to have a unified force theory. And both of those were demolished, and it's now dogmatic that there are other things out there that we need to learn about in order to have a complete theory. So where do these ideas come from? Dr. Dean talked about the liberal arts. You know, the origin of the university is rooted in the notion that there are ways of knowing that liberate us and free us to be able to be lifelong learners. And these are called the liberal arts. They were first described by these two gentlemen who you may have heard about before. And it's really the essence of the idea of a university. And one could argue that Aristotle's school was really the ultimate origins of the notion of a university. As I mentioned, I think the nature and calling of the human person is to do these things, and that to do that, we have to understand these things that the ancients described as the transcendentals, but such a notion as truth and goodness and unity and beauty are really sort of essential to the formation of the human person to be able to learn and to know and to contribute meaningfully to society. So how do we do this? Well, I would argue we go forward with integrity. We figure out how to put the parts back together so that they're not divided. And we're in a little bit of danger of that happening with universities. In fact, there's a great book that I think I have a slide on it later. Alistair McIntyre talked about God, philosophy, and universities. And in that book, he says that we're in danger of universities really becoming multiversities, where there is no unity of knowledge. There is no ability to understand the whole rather than the specialized compartment. So this is, first of all, what are the liberal arts? Well, there were two parts to the liberal arts. The first part, the trivium, were what were called the logical arts, grammar, rhetoric, dialectic. And these were intended to be the foundation stone on which you build the other arts. And the logical arts were intended to equip you with the ways of thinking that would enable you to apprehend all of the other arts, which were called the real arts, or sometimes the physical arts, or the servile arts. In other words, this is where the person puts themselves at the disposal of the society to serve the society in a way. Now, many years ago, that was through arithmetic, geometry, astronomy, music. Now it's engineering, business, law. These are the servile arts. These are instrumental arts. But the foundation was how to know things and how to intellect in all the ways that you're supposed to. Dorothy Sayers, the wise lady that she was, says, without this essential training in thinking, arguing, communicating, all the higher orders of intellection, young persons are not equipped to study subjects. So we get a degree in a subject, but we've got to have that foundation. We've got to have these intellection skills. We've got to be empowered to have lifelong learning. She says, with the loss of the trivium, and I would argue its modern equivalent, whatever that is, knowledge gets fragmented. And how do you put knowledge back together again? We don't want our students to be servile experts. We want them to be well-formed human persons that are equipped to solve the most important problems of the 21st century. And you better believe these are important problems. Problems like sustainability, and problems like energy, and problems like climate change. And these are outsized problems that require the most brilliant of our young people to be fully armed to try to solve these issues. I mentioned McIntyre, so I'll move on. We won't beat a dead horse. I would argue that going back to the whole, going back to beauty, truth, goodness, unity, and understanding purpose is a tool, is a means for helping us apprehend the whole. So we want to apprehend the whole. We want to put things in context. We want to understand holistically the problem if we're going to tackle that problem in an appropriate and effective way. So how do we do that? This is a slide I stole from Daniel Little, and I really have to thank him. And I don't know if you can read this slide. I'm actually having trouble reading it right now. But he argues that the modes of intellectual work are extending an existing tradition, completing unfinished problems within a tradition. I'm going to go to my notes here so I get it right. Normal science, whatever that is, formulating new ideas and hypotheses and testing them, conceiving new ways of putting together the components of a problem. I've taken all of these things that Daniel talks about and I've given them a name on the right. Extension, completion, testable hypotheses, ideation, synthesis, transference, translation, application, and paradigm shifts. I would argue these are all higher level intellection skills that we should be arming our students with if we want them to be fully equipped to solve climate change. To solve, one of the examples I gave at lunch today was We've been saying for 100 years that we're 50 years away from making nuclear fusion practicable. When are we going to actually make it practicable? It's an engineering problem, by the way. It's not really a science problem. We know what nuclear fusion is. It's really the ultimate in sustainability, because it's like making a little sun in a bottle. It's hard, very challenging, but it's going to require all these skills and then some. So let me now talk about really the punchline of my talk, which is the highest mode of intellection. Everything that I just described, all of Daniel Little's methods, are what these two gentlemen, maybe you've heard of them, Thomas Aquinas and John Duns Scotus, two philosophers, two theologians in the middle part of the 13th century, very early part of the 14th century, they talked about two ways of intellection, ratio and intellectus. And ratio is what you, all of you in this audience, are so familiar with. Ratio is analysis. Ratio is synthesis. It is tearing a problem apart into its bits and solving each problem in part and then putting it back together again to come up with the solution. You all are really good at this. Engineers do this a lot. But intellectus is, I would argue, equally important. So what do we mean by this? So there was a little book, and I highly recommend it, called Leisure, the Basis of Culture. It was written by a German philosopher, Joseph Pieper, in 1947, right after World War II. At the same time, there was an essay written by Vannevar Bush. And if you don't know who Vannevar Bush was, he was the vice president of MIT. He was the founder of the National Science Foundation in the United States. Vannevar Bush was a bigger-than-life character. He was on the cover of Time magazine in the mid-40s. And he wrote a book on the way to think, or excuse me, an essay on the way to think. And Vannevar Bush's concept was very similar to Joseph Pieper's concept. And it was this concept of leisure. So leisure has a very interesting word origin. It comes from the Latin word schola, which comes from the Greek word schola, which, by the way, is the root of the word school. And schola in Greek meant leisure. That's our modern word leisure. Now, we've managed to misunderstand what the Greeks meant by leisure. What they meant was not anything that was idleness or pure relaxation. What they meant was a receptive way of learning. So what Aquinas and Scotus called intellectus was what the Greeks meant by leisure. And Aristotle actually said, we work, and the word that he used for work was ascholia, the opposite of schola, so that we can be at leisure, schola. Because he thought schola was really the higher order mode of knowing. And so what do we mean by, what we mean by ratio is discursive thought, searching and researching, abstracting, concluding, refining, and analysis. What we mean by intellectus is receptive looking, or gazing, or creative reception. So the way I articulated it with my colleagues earlier this afternoon is human beings are often so busy acting that we forget to pause and receive. And if you don't ever receive, then you never get what you're supposed to get. And what is it that we receive? Well, I'd like to focus a little bit on that. So how do we apply this to the creation of a curriculum? I would argue that we want to be able to intellectually receive the big picture, or what phenomenologists and philosophers call the radiant form of being. Either the being of an idea or the being of a thing, but we have to have a healthy balance of ratio, which is us acting and doing, as well as intellectus, which is us receiving and understanding the big picture. And I'm hoping I can give you a couple of examples in my concluding remarks. I'm trying to see what the time is here, make sure I'm not going over my time. Jacques Maritain, who was a, you may have heard of him, famous scholastic philosopher of the early part of the 20th century, said, "Form is the ontological secret that things bear with them, their operating mystery. Above all, the proper principle of intelligibility, the proper clarity of everything, a vestige or ray of the creative intelligence at the heart of created being." I would argue everything that is created, and indeed everything that we create, and human beings are blessed to be able to create many things. All of the artifacts of our society and our culture, all of our technologies, everything engineers create, it has form to it. And in particular, Maritain talks about radiant form. He says, "Form is the reason we can know and understand reality, and thus it is the source of light in things. Form manifests the inner radiance of things." And so how do you perceive radiant form? Well, you have to use this higher order intellection skill, intellectus. You have to pause from all you're doing and acting, and you have to receive the principle of intelligibility that is rooted in things. This is how you discover things. This is how you create ideas which solve problems. This is how you think out of the box. How do you get out of the box if you don't pause long enough to be stimulated by something that gets you out of the box? So what are some good ways to practice intellectus? How do we get at this radiant form? I would argue that beauty and integrity are great ways of getting out of the box, of developing this skill of intellectus. And so there are many examples in engineering practice that I could give you of encouraging students to think deeply, to think reflectively, to be in a receiving mode, and to be creative once they've received. And let me just give you a few examples. So first of all, and by the way, this is being both left and right brained. I think engineering is one of those disciplines that really puts the two parts of the brain together. So let's talk a little bit about beauty. This is a dictionary definition of beauty. These are some of the qualities of beauty, and I'm going to focus on just two of them. I'm going to focus on harmony, namely balance and symmetry, and I'm going to focus on mystery, because I think mystery is really a very important quality of beauty. So here's a few examples, and I'm just going to focus in on snowflakes and one plant example. This, I borrowed this from another talk that I've given. So here's some pictures of snowflakes. And what's the first thing you notice about snowflakes when you look at them? Well, one obvious thing that kind of jumps off the page at you is there's a lot of symmetry in snowflakes. They're all mostly all hexagonal. They have very characteristic structures that seem to repeat themselves with topology and principles of order and rotation axes and so on. But the other thing that is absolutely apparent about crystals, about snowflakes, is that there's something mysterious in every snowflake. And you've probably heard this. Every snowflake is unique. So there are defects, there are dislocations, there are disclination planes, there are things in the snowflake that renders it this unique quality that no other snowflake has. And so the beauty is rooted in both the symmetry, the balance, the harmony, but also the mystery that's implicit in the snowflake. Let me give you another example. This is one of my favorites. Beautiful, beautiful thing to reflect upon, a rose. There's so much in that rose that you could analyze, you could ratio on. So for example, the petals rotate almost perfectly according to the Fibonacci sequence. So if any of you have ever studied the irrational number phi, phi is embedded in the Fibonacci sequence, and I can show you with the detailed analysis how the Fibonacci sequence is embedded in that rose. Now, why is that? Okay, the other thing you will notice is that there are axes of symmetry that are not perfect. You'll also notice there's a lot of very great detail in the leaf structure. So there, I could ratio the rose, and I could pull all sorts of information out about the rose. But what would you much rather do with a rose? You'd much rather intellectus the rose, right? Because the rose has so much to reveal to us about its radiant form, about its principle of intelligibility, its aroma, its beauty. We're just drawn to it. Now let me give you some engineering examples. And I had to manufacture these a little bit, so bear with me. I'm going to talk about bridges and airplanes, and I'll give one Mazdar example, and I'll make some concluding remarks. So there are some wonderfully, beautifully integrated bridges, which you can intellectus. Here's an example. I got this off a website on bridges in nature. I would just enjoy gazing on the beauty and the integration of the bridge. And it might inspire me. It might give me a very interesting idea of how I can solve my problem. Here's another one. This is the Millau Viaduct over the River Tarn in France. It's half a kilometer in the air, and it spans 2 kilometers in distance. I think it's the highest bridge in the world. And it is an engineering marvel. And here's another beautiful photo of the Millau Viaduct. One more if you haven't had enough. Okay, let's talk about an airplane. This is maybe an overworked example, but the Boeing Dreamliner is really a spectacular airplane. It is, I would argue, beautiful in its own right. But it's actually a remarkable example of systems engineering. The amount of supply chain organization, the amount of engineering, the sustainability of this airplane, there's so much that went into the Dreamliner, which is absolutely extraordinary. It's really kind of an engineering marvel. And it's brand new. How many people have ridden on a Dreamliner? It's a unique experience. So I rode on the maiden voyage of a Dreamliner from Santiago, Chile to Buenos Aires. It was a LAN Dreamliner. It still had the plastic everywhere on the covers and everything. And my colleague, Juan Carlos de la Liera Martin, who's the Dean of Engineering at the Pontificia Universidad de Católica in Santiago, he and I were just giddy with excitement as we got on this plane because we'd never ridden on one before. And it's a marvel. It saves 30% on fuel. They've got, I think, 2,000 orders for them now. It's really quite amazing. There's a lot of ratio that went into this plane, but I would argue there's a lot of intellectos that had to go into this plane or they never would have come up with it. And there's a nice pretty picture off the Boeing website. And then finally, how many people are familiar with Mazdar? So Mazdar is a completely engineered city in Abu Dhabi, which has a zero carbon footprint. It's totally sustainable. And it's actually quite beautiful. And this is an overhead view of Mazdar. So why do I give you these examples? Because I think in higher education, we want to be able to recover this notion that comes to us from the medievals, who actually, I think, got it right, that there is a mode of intellection that we have to be intentional about putting into our curricula and that we have to integrate within what we're about at universities. I think it's important. We want our students to discover within themselves what their most preciously held values are, what their purpose in life is, their vocation, if you'll allow me to use that term. We want them to understand how they're motivated to carry out their educational profession, their engineering profession. And I think one of the ways we do that is by exposing them to a much greater degree to this mode of learning. And so, just a few closing thoughts. The reason this is so important is because the challenges we face in society have never been more daunting. Decisions that we make in South Bend and that you make in Hamilton, I would argue, impact everyone on the planet. Everyone on the planet is impacted by your purchasing decisions, your living decisions, every decision you make. You're impacting people in Africa and Asia. I mean, we are a global village now. And it's a trite expression, but it's true. It's absolutely true. And the challenges that the global village faces are serious, and they're important. And we have to be united. We have to go forward with integrity if we're going to solve these challenges in a human way, worthy of humans. I think that requires both ratio and intellectus. And our curricula should reflect these elements. And I used a number of sources. These are just a few of them. I'd be happy to take any questions that you have. And thank you, Ishwar, for inviting me to give this talk. It's the first time I've ever given it. I hope I didn't bore you or make it overly simplistic. But I think it is an important issue as educators that we have to try to address. Thank you very much. Thank you, Rafi. Okay, absolutely, yeah.
Good afternoon. My name is Raphael Kleiman, the chair of the Hodgins Lectureship Committee. The focus of the lectureship is on the engineer and society in recognition of the breadth and interest of the contributions of Dr. Hodgins. As the chair of the lectureship committee, it's been my distinct pleasure to help in selecting speakers who can speak to the community on important issues in society where engineers can or have made a significant impact. I'd really like to thank Dr. Kilpatrick for delivering his lecture so clearly on this point. He's spoken so eloquently on these issues in his lecture today on the meaning and purpose of higher education in an engineering context. So we have a bit of time today for questions to be addressed to Dr. Kilpatrick. I can't imagine there won't be an infinite number of questions that may arise. Please refrain from comments and keep your questions brief in order to allow for time for answers to those questions. So who'd like to begin? Okay, so right here we have one.
Oh. Thank you, Rafi. Please.
Do you have a specific examples of how you envision the idea of intellectus being integrated into, say, an engineering curriculum?
Yeah, I think very important way to do that is to motivate with really good examples of projects, designs, challenges that require intellectus or that manifest the integration of this mode of intellection in their solution. And, you know, again, the few examples that I gave were intended to be illustrative. I think it's important that engineering students understand that this is that integrity, that beauty, that goodness and truth are really important elements to weave into your engineering solution. And I think the more we exploit, if you'll allow me to use that term, the transcendentals in illustrating great engineering design, great engineering accomplishments, I think the more students will be inspired to say, oh my gosh, I get it. And in fact, I want to be part of that. I want to help solve the sustainable energy challenge in a way that's beautiful and whole and true. I want to help solve the
nitrate problem in agriculture in a way that's elegant and beautiful and whole and good. And there are ways to do that, by the way. Moving away from annuals to perennials in a way that exploits the goodness of the sustainability of the plant is actually a very clever idea, which I think manifests truth, beauty, goodness, and unity. So I hope that's an adequate answer.
Dr. Barber.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Could you describe what it looks like if we get unbalanced, and I assume we're always unbalanced. Balance is very difficult. But in either way, in these two things you've been talking about, if we go one way too strong and sacrifice the other.
That's a great question.
What does it look like?
Doug, thank you for that. I wouldn't have expected anything less from you than a very insightful question. So gazing at your navel and never learning your craft as an engineer would be going a little too far on the intellectus side. I mean, and again, please allow me to use my cultural framework, but Pope John Paul, when he was Pope, wrote a beautiful encyclical on human labor. So work, ratio, acting, doing, it has dignity. And I don't want in any way to deny the importance and the dignity of that. It's crucial. And you can't be a lazy layabout and really contribute to the important transformation of society. But by the same token, if you're a technocrat who cares nothing about the good of the other, you know, the vulnerable, the impoverished, the people who have no one to champion their cause around the globe, if you don't appreciate that you're part of a global village and that you have responsibilities, and you don't take the time to reflect and to receive the goodness of the others and understand that in a holistic way, then I think you've erred very much on the ratio side. So absolutely, I'm trying to struggle for the expression, but this is the middle way. This is the yin and the yang. This is the via excellent, you know. I hope I've answered your question, but those are two ways that I see. And if you want me to put that in more concrete context, I think some people worry too much about human values without ever becoming skilled enough to contribute to the good of society. And by the same token, people do things for the wrong reasons. People, chase, idols, money, sex, power, whatever your idol is, and they don't think clearly enough about the other. So there's many ways we can get out of balance. And they're both things to be careful to avoid. Yeah.
Thank you. It was an excellent presentation. You started off with sort of highlighting the challenges that are faced by higher education, and one of them being costs. And I was hoping you would return back to that theme, specifically thinking about, the societal pressure on certain disciplines within a university being well-funded and supported and students wanting to go into those disciplines like science, engineering, biomedical, health sciences, et cetera. And the rest of the university, which is sort of all of the intellectia side of the university, humanities, social sciences, not getting the societal funding and some would say equitable funding at the university.
Yeah.
And specifically, what is the role of engineers in supporting that aspect of the university?
Yeah, it's a great question, and my apologies for not taking the time in my lecture to do that, because it is an important issue. So one of the things we've done at Notre Dame is develop the idea that all students, including students in the humanities and students in the social sciences, should have the opportunity to be exposed to what I would call technological literacy. So I think one of the ways that universities can address this is say, look, if your predilection is to major in English, which is, you know, my favorite subjects, maybe this will come as no surprise to the audience, my favorite subjects were the humanities when I was an undergraduate at Occidental College. I loved them. I was always, you know, just very intellectually stimulated by learning architecture and literature and anthropology, and you know, it was wonderful. So I think one of the things we can do is partner with them and say, look, you can be a historian. If you learn a little bit of quantitation, a little bit of technological literacy, you can use all of your gifts as a humanist, but now you have the ability to go do many different things in society in addition to your history or your English. And so that's one way to try to address this. I think we have to be very, very careful to hold up the value of all the disciplines, but more importantly, of the integration of the disciplines. Because, you know, I would like to see universities go back to the day when they were a university instead of a multiversity. I hope that answers your question.
So that talk was wonderful, and as you could predict, music to my ears in lots of ways. So my question is just to step on from the last question you asked, which was about the role humanities can play in I suppose sort of advancing that kind of cross-fertilization between the technologically oriented disciplines and this kind of humanistic perspective. My question is, so, you know, this, the talk of radiant form and so on is very, very specific to Maritain and that scholastic tradition.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a sense that when you look across the university to the humanities and the social sciences, do you have a sense that that mandate is still being pursued there, or we're in a different place? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I think, and I'm going to editorialize here. Yeah. I think in academic disciplines, we have a strong tendency to want to innovate all the time. You know, it's our academic predilection. I have to innovate. I have to write, you know, the next interesting paper on the next interesting theory on, you know, and I have to leave tradition behind. I need, you know, these are worn out, tired ideas, and I need to leave them behind. And I think there's a danger in that. You know, for human persons to assume that only the newest and most innovative ideas are good, and everything that came before it is tired and old and we need to be done with it, I think is dangerous. And so my sense is that many academic disciplines around the universities around the world have striven, if that's a word, to innovate in their disciplines, and so scholasticism and then neo-scholasticism have become really branded as tired, worn-out theories from which we cannot extract anything of value anymore. And while I certainly understand that we don't want to cling to tradition tenaciously simply because it's old, I think we should be open to the idea that these ancient thinkers and even these not so ancient thinkers have something to teach us, something to reveal to us. There are some ideas in there that can be revisited with great fruitfulness. And just as I think we have to be open to the newest of ideas, because after all, it's part of the nature of the human person to create. You know, it's built into our DNA. You know, we are creative, loving, knowing creatures. And we should celebrate that. So I hope I answered your question.
Okay, one last question, please.
Hi, Peter. Great talk. Do you have any practical suggestions for, say, an engineering faculty that wants to bring literature, archaeology, humanities into the curriculum to round out the experience of their students? And how do they resist the pressure either from the funders or from the specialists who say, we don't have time for that?
Yeah, it's a very, Jeff, very important question. And I wrestle with my department chairs all the time about this exact issue. I think one possible answer is we shouldn't be so married to the 3-credit-hour course that we can't think in innovative new ways about our curriculum. So I know in many universities, many colleges, people have gone to the courselet or the nano degree, or you know, people have gone to the modular approach to learning without sacrificing any rigor, but recognizing that, okay, if I'm gonna, and let me pick on a discipline because I guess I'm the invited speaker, so I get to do that if I want to. So in civil engineering, transportation is an important component that ABET says you need to have knowledge of some transportation. And in our university, we're not a public university. We don't have DOT funding at Notre Dame, so we don't have a lot of transportation engineers. So my department chair, who I love dearly, he's a wonderful, wonderful person, has decided, okay, we'll bring in an adjunct to teach this 3-credit-hour course in transportation. And I've told him, I said, Ioannis, couldn't you teach the fundamentals of transportation in 1-credit-hour module and maybe combine it with a couple of other modules that go into this 3-credit-hour slot that give the kind of background that you want your students to have, but then open up some space in their curriculum so they could do other things, either more advanced, deeper studies in engineering, or perhaps even, you know, a humanities course or a philosophy course. And, oh, no, we couldn't do that. And I'm not sure I understand why not. So I think as we begin to appropriate technologies that enable us to deliver content as well as assessment in more and more creative ways, I think people will begin to do experiments with alternative approaches to crafting their curriculum. And that could be part of the solution to your question, Jeff. But it's a great question. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I really
thank you,
Ralph.
Appreciate it.
So as the lectureship comes to a close, I'd like to invite Ryan Rogers up to the podium, who's the president-elect of MES. Please, Ryan.
Thank you, Dr. Kleiman, for the introduction. As was mentioned earlier in the lecture, March is Engineering Month, and I can't think of a better way to celebrate the profession, such as lectures as this one. A lot of times as a student, I find myself controlled by the routine of assignments and midterms and exams that comes with being an engineering student. And it's lectures such as this that really ground me in reality and make me realize that it's not the piece of paper I get at the end of my degree that matters, but actually the education I learn. So with that in mind, I'd like to present Dr. Kilpatrick with the John Hodgins Memorial Lecture plaque. Thank you so much for taking the time to come in today and present us the 31st Hodgins Lecture.
Ryan, thank you so much. Really, really appreciate that. Thank you very much. Appreciate that.
And now I'd like to invite Dean Perry to come up and give some closing remarks.
Thank you very much, Ryan. Once again, thank you all for being here. Thank you, Patrick, for opening the lecture. Peter, thank you very much for an absolutely marvelous lecture. Rafi and Ryan for your participation, and all of you for listening and participating. And I'd also like to thank all of our visitors from around the world who are watching this. We've welcomed you to McMaster. We thank you for being here. This is indeed a place where we think with integrity about matters with a social consciousness. So thank you all. Thank you for being here. This concludes our lecture. If you'd like to visit briefly with Dr. Kilpatrick, I'm sure he'd be very pleased to speak with you. Thank you again.